Thanks for the opportunity to speak today. I'm Indonesian, so I acknowledge that. I hope that my work on West Papua can is representative enough to deliver speak about West Papua today, because I'm wanted by Indonesian police for my work. They are also seeking a red notice from the Interpol, threatened to revoke my passport, threatened to freeze my bank account. So it must disturb the Indonesian government. I will speak briefly about the current situation right now in West Papua, and then I'll go to the history, which is the root cause of the conflict, and it's how it intertwines with colonialism and imperialism. And then lastly, about what solidarity can do for West Papua. So just first December, it means less than 2 weeks ago, first December annually, West Papuans commemorate their Independence Day, their National Day, which I will go to the history later on the next point. So on that day, it's usually because they commemorate their National Day, it usually followed by crackdown by the Indonesian government. So we have 126 arrests and 61 new political prisoners charged with treason. By treason, meaning facing 20 years imprisonment. That's all for mostly these people were arrested on their way, suspected on their way to raise the Morning Star flags. So nothing violent about that, facing treason. And so back then, the context of the world in revolt back to the August, September this year. The protests went on for 32 days, but lack of much less coverage than in Hong Kong or anywhere else, precisely because the media, the international journalists, international organization are banned from entering West Papua. So during that time, hundreds of thousands of West Papuans took to the streets demanding independence referendum. So in the first week, it was protest against racism, which because in the mid-August, 6-7 Indonesian military police shouted, "Hey, monkeys, get out! Monkeys, get out!" at in front of the West Papuan students' dorm in Java, and that video sparked anger. Finally, the West Papuans have enough. It's the tipping point, and which then triggers. And so in the first week of the protest, it was still against racism. But the second week until September, until end of September 23rd to be precise, it was about demanding independence referendum. And that's why the Indonesian government shut down the internet, because the Indonesia didn't want you to see so many people demanding independence referendum. And during that uprising, I'll refer to it as West Papua uprising, 61 civilians died, more than 100 injured, and some of those are killed and injured by civilian militias. We are seeing this concerning tactics again that was implemented in East Timor back then by using civilian militias. And there were more than 100 arrests with 22 people charged with treason. Again, these 22 people were non-violent. They were, during protest, they fly the Morning Star flags. So in just 3 months, we have new 84 political prisoners charged with treason. All are non-violent, just because of the Morning Star flags. And the current situation now, since this uprising, Indonesia has deployed extra, at least, these are, because this number is what is announced in the media, so at least extra 10,000 extra military and police been deployed into West Papua. And on daily basis, I get photos, image, basically that armed paramilitary police patrolling in residential area, in universities, in churches, and like they are everywhere. So de facto, in West Papua is a militarized zone. And that is why Indonesia is like international community is now pushing Indonesia to let the UN Human Rights Office in. But I say that Indonesia is will not allow them in precisely because they don't want them to see this. It's, it will be too confronting. And right now there's a currently a displacement of at least 60,000 civilians across West Papua. Most of them, 45,000 of them, were from since last year. Since 4th December last year, due to the military operation in Duga area, that in a year, 238 civilians have died. Some were shot dead, burnt alive in their traditional houses, but most of them died due to hunger and sickness. These 45 people, displaced people, are not acknowledged by Jakarta. So they are not assisted at all. In a normal world, they will be assisted by IOM, International Organization for Migration, IOM, and UNHCR. But Indonesia, Jakarta will not acknowledge them because if they acknowledge these displaced people, it means Indonesia acknowledges that there's conflict. So even donation collection or protest, like what is it called, like candles,
vigil,
it was dispersed by police, like not allowed at all. So that is the current situation in West Papua. What is the cause? This never ending conflict since 1961 began in 1961. The national day that I mentioned earlier on 1st December 1961, at the time the Dutch already gave the manifest promise basically to West Papua that you'll be independent like in 10 years. So at the, on that day, they for the first time their national flag, the Morning Star, was raised, their national anthem was sung, and their national parliament was established. 18 days later, on 19 December, Indonesia invaded West Papua. So in Indonesian our school books, we were taught that how heroic Indonesia was at that time, liberating West Papuans from the Dutch. But for West Papuans, that is the beginning of the invasion, of the colonial occupation. And then in the 1962, there was because of the Cold War politics at that time, like the U.S. said to the Dutch, like, okay, you know, as the middle compromise, then have the New York Agreement at that time, which the main clause at that time is to hold a plebiscite. One person, one vote at that time it was stated. But then in 1967, before the plebiscite took place 2 years later, Freeport, the U.S., so the U.S. government and the Indonesian government made agreement about Freeport. So later on in 1969, where the plebiscite took place, only 1,026 people out of 800,000 West Papuans at that time were handpicked under intimidation and gunpoint to choose Indonesia. This is because Indonesia has promised the gold, the biggest gold mine in the world in West Papua to the US. So West Papua is not just about Indonesian colonialism, it's about US imperialism. So like to free West Papua, it's about to fight the US. That's why it is goddamn hard. Many of us say that when the gold in West Papua is finished, then maybe Indonesia will finally let West Papua go. It's because of the interest of imperialism is there, so it's difficult. And that is the root cause of the conflict, and that is why West Papuans are demanding what they call is a democratic solution, that is re-referendum. In accordance to international practice, one person, one vote, that's what they want. And so, like, how is it? So since the very beginning, West Papuans live under Indonesia. It's racism. Like even on daily basis, there's a during the uprising, a BBC Indonesia made a short documentary of how these West Papuan students in Java. Often I already know this, but I mean like this is more like, you know, it's documentary. These students face discrimination on daily basis, like when they go on public transport, Indonesian would like pinch their nose, classic racism against black people. And like my colleague once like was prohibited to enter a public event at a university because he's black. And so they are taught in their in school, West Papuans are taught in school that you are clever if you eat rice like the Javanese. And so and now like this the rapid deforestation palm oil plantation in West Papua, that they are also made to like huge chunk of land of rice paddies. Well, West Papuans traditional they don't eat rice, so they are made classic colonial strategy as well, make the people dependent to you. So West Papuans are being like forced to eat rice while they don't know how to grow rice, and they are also made ashamed with their skin color, their hair, their curly hair. And as a human rights lawyer, I cannot think any single human rights that is not violated in West Papua. Like they have the highest rate of HIV/AIDS, highest mortality rates of mother giving birth, and lowest life expectancy in the country, the poorest region in the country. Well, it's actually the richest. So it's classic colonialism. Almost in my last point about like solidarity. So among Indonesian people in 29 November 2016, so it's actually pretty recent, that my friends and I, we co-founded this Front Indonesian People for West Papua. It's basically the first groups of Indonesians publicly supporting right to self-determination of West Papuan people. And the spokesperson, a really good friend of mine, is now in prison, charged with treason. And so like we have now this uprising, there's really significant involvement, solidarity by Indonesian people, that Indonesians could be seen leading the march angrily in Java during the uprising. And we have now the first Indonesian ever charged with treason, my friend Surya. And this group is so small compared to the total population of Indonesia, but it's beginning. We are mostly, the group is mostly student organizations and leftists. And like we have like classic leftists, right? Like we fight against each other. My argument is the best while the right is like rising. But in our group we say like we don't care, like especially the Leninists and anarchists, right? Like shut up, we don't want to care about your ideology. It's how we like gather together how to make impact for West Papua cause. So actually something is happening. Right, yes, Maoist. It's beginning to really making a disturbing the Indonesian government. And as Australians, my last point, like what you can do. I think that because like it's surprisingly so few Australians, because I studied my master's in Australia, and like my classmates, they didn't know what happening in West Papua. It's like you can literally swim to West Papua, right, from top of Australia, but they didn't know what's happening. So I think that as simple as do more public discussions, do more publications or public discussions about West Papua, like talk about it, That's the minimum, I think, and to attend protest, because like at the end of the day, I believe that change will come from the people. The government should listen to the people. I believe in people power. And what is this? My writing, sorry. And talk to your MPs. Like, make them know that you are concerned with West Papua. Why are you silent? Why are you not saying anything about what's happening in West Papua? So, yep, that's it from me. Thank you.